हम दीन दुखी निबलो विकलो के सेवक बन संताप हरे, जो है बिछुड़े भूले भटके उनको तारे खुद तर जावे। वह शक्ति हमें दो दयानी दे, कर्तव्य मार्ग पर डट जावे। छल द्वेष दंभ पाखंड झूठ अन्याय से निश दिन दूर रहे, जीवन हो शुद्ध सरल अपना, शुचि प्रेम सुधा रस बरसाए। वह शक्ति हमें दो दयानी दे, कर्तव्य मार्ग पर डट जावे। निज आन मान मर्यादा का प्रभु ध्यान रहे, अभिमान रहे। जिस देव भूमि में जन्म लिया, बलिदान उसी पर हो जावे। वह शक्ति हमें दो दयानी दे, कर्तव्य मार्ग पर डट जावे। So, I welcome everyone once again. And let's start today's topic. And today's topic, we will delve into the concept of key. So, generally I say that these are unexplored topics, and we don't get full details in the books or in other places. So it is my own understanding and my own analysis. So there could be mistakes in what I say. Okay, so that's why I always say this: take it with a pinch of salt. Okay, so today we will try to understand the concept of key in different regions of the world. Different names are given to the same thing. In India, we call it prana. In some places, they call it bioenergy. Some places, chi. In some places, it is ki. And some places, it is called vital force. So it is all one and the same. But we will start using the name as ki. So last time also I had mentioned this analogy. So we have a house, and in the house there are some wirings going on, and within that wire there is electricity flowing. Okay, so there is house, and within the house there are wirings, and within the wire there is electricity flowing. So, but in house, say the house is visible, wire is visible, but the electricity is invisible. In this analogy, the house is visible, the wires are also visible, but this electricity which is flowing within that wire is invisible. And we will try to extend the same thing into the human body. Exactly the same thing. So even in human system, there is a body like a house, and within the body there are meridians like wires, and within that meridian there is ki, the energy which is flowing. The only thing is, here even the meridian is also invisible. Only the body is visible. Okay, so there is body which is visible, and within that body there are invisible meridians flowing in different format. Don't worry about these colors and the different directions. Just ignore it for time being. Just think that there is different energy pathways in the body. And within this energy pathway, there is this ki, or the energy which is flowing. Both the meridian and the ki are invisible. Only the body is visible. Okay. So let's, until here, like most of us know, like say 99% of the people who have joined in this classes are able to understand up to now. Okay. So let's take it slightly one step further. So this key, which we are telling, which is invisible, is a combination of five invisible energies. How is that? Okay, that is what we will try to understand. We know that this entire existence or the human body is made out of five elements. Okay. So those are wood, fire, earth, metal, and water as per Chinese. But in Ayurveda, we say Akash is metal and Vayu is wood. Okay, so Akash, Vayu, Agni, Jal or Prithvi. That is, these are the five elements with which the entire world or the entire physical existence is created. In Chinese philosophy, each of these elements is associated with an invisible energy. Like say, for example, wood is associated with wind. Fire is associated with heat. Earth is associated with humidity. Metal or space is associated with dryness, and water is associated with coldness. How do we understand this? Say fire is visible. We can see the fire, but the heat emitting out of the fire is invisible, right? We can't touch and feel the heat. We can only feel the heat. I can't touch it. Okay. Only I can touch the fire, but not the heat. Say when in winter, you would have seen some people put a bonfire and they sit outside, you know, around the fire. So the fire is burning, but it is radiating heat. I can see the fire, but not the heat. Similarly, I can see the water, but I cannot see the coldness within the water. I can only feel it. When I touch the water, I feel that it is cold, right? And similarly, the air, which is wood. In this example of TCM, I can see the wood or the tree, but the wind is not visible. I can only feel it, right? Similarly, all these are visible energies and these are its associated invisible energies. All this is pretty basic fundamental things up till now. Okay, all of us would have studied these things. So let us take it one step further. Now, these are visible things and each of them have invisible. When I combine all these invisible energies, all these five invisible energy and put it together, I call it as key. Key is a summation of these five invisible energies. Okay. So the energies is invisible. So when I put together, the key is also invisible. Okay. So here, that is what I have shown it in this equation. Key, which is invisible, is the summation of these five energies: wind, heat, humidity, dryness, coldness, and all these are also invisible. So now I know that key is a summation of these five fundamental invisible energies, and this is also invisible. Let's go further. So now I know that this is invisible and it has five energies. But what is the proportion of it? Okay. So there are five invisible things in that key and each of them have different proportions. But if I say that each of them are equally proportionate, then each of them will be 20%. So it is like key is 100%. And if you split it into five, each of them will be 20% each. Wind, heat, humidity, dryness, and coldness. So depending on the proportions of these independent or individual energies in the key, the nature of the key or the quality of the key is decided. Okay. So if say wind is more, okay, say another 5% more or 10% more, So these things will decrease correspondingly. So I have shown that in the next figure. Okay, let us see this example. See, in this, all of them are equally distributed. Say 20%, 20% of coldness, wind, heat. Now, one of these five energy is it is becoming disproportionate. Okay. Say, for example, I have shown here it is heat as 60%. Now, in the remaining 40%, these wind, cold, dryness, and humidity gets distributed. So this is a variation from the equal distribution. It doesn't mean when there is excess heat distribution, it is unhealth, and when there is equal distribution, it is health. No, that is not the meaning. Here, this is just for illustration. These topics I will take in future, but just for understanding. Imagine there is a pipe, and within that pipe, water is flowing. Some liquid can flow. I have taken the water. So similarly, there is a meridian, which is an invisible pipe. And this, within this invisible pipe, these energies in a combined form is flowing. Sometimes they are equal in proportion, and sometimes they are unequal in proportion. And we know that those who have studied the first semester, they know there are different kinds of meridians. Like, for example, let's say different types of pipes. Okay. And in each of those pipes, there is a different proportion in which these five energies have to move. Broadly, these pipes are divided into yin and yang. Okay, let's not get into the details. If you don't know, don't worry about it. We will discuss it later. But those who know, there are two kinds of energies. In a coin, there are two phases, head and tail. Something similar, you understand. Okay, I will take questions later. Okay, I see somebody has raised a hand. So let's keep all your questions. And in the later part, we will answer because the flow will get disconnected. Okay, there's a pipe, and within that, all these five energies are flowing. Sometimes they are proportionate, and sometimes they are disproportionate. And we know that there are two kinds of pipe, okay, yin and yang. Okay, just like a two phases of a coin, head and tail, we have yin and yang. And when the energy is flowing in an yin meridian, it has to have the qualities of yin nature. The yin nature has to be brought into this energy. And when it is flowing in the yang energy, in a yang meridian, the distribution of these five energies should be yang in nature. Heat is yang. Okay. So when it is flowing in a yang meridian, the proportion of heat should be more. Okay. And when it is flowing in, or it could be wind for that matter in yang. And when it is flowing through a yin meridian, okay, the coldness has to be more. Okay, let's say coldness is 40% or 50%. Rest all will be lesser relatively. So this energy combination proportions keep on changing while they are moving with different meridians. And even in yin meridian, there are few kind of variations in it. And in a yang meridian, there are few variations in it. So let us, those who are new, no need to worry about those things. Only this much you understand. We will take that up in a future session. Okay. So now we came to know that there are five energies. And in TCM, we know that there are five pair of organs allocated to manage these five different energies. Here we can call it as elements or energies. Okay. So we know that say liver and gallbladder is allocated to manage the wind. Heart and small intestine is allocated to heat. Spleen and stomach is allocated to manage humidity. Lungs and large intestine is allocated to manage dryness. Kidney and urinary bladder is allocated to manage coldness. So two organs is managing one energy or element. So until now, I think it is clear. So let's go further. So when you see this table, one thing should come into your mind. There is one energy, but why is that there are two organs allocated to manage one energy? Anybody is getting this question? Okay. Why not just one organ? Okay. Why is that two organ is needed or allocated to manage one particular energy? So this is how I understand it. Should I answer that question?
Hello. Hello, we can't hear you. Your voice is not audible.
Hello, not audible.
Not audible.
Not audible.
Is it better now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Did you hear all these time that I was talking, or it was not audible at all? All the previous.
Not audible.
It was not audible in between.
Okay.
In between.
So, the last question we heard is why the two organs are paired.
Okay. Why two organs are paired?
In one element, why two organs?
Okay. But the previous things, was it audible? Like, did you hear, or should I just repeat?
Yes.
No, we heard. We could hear.
You could hear all of it. Okay.
Yes. Okay.
Okay. So my question is, there are two organs allocated for one energy. What could be the reason? Should I answer it now, or anyone want to take a guess?
Yin and organ.
Yin and yang. What does it mean?
Okay. Every energy has two-sided. Like, morning and evening, day and night, there are two sides for any person or any things. That's the reason, maybe, I guess.
Okay, yeah. There is nothing wrong in sharing your present understanding. It doesn't mean that what I share is the ultimate. No, it is only my way of understanding things. Anybody else has any other idea why two organs are allocated to manage one energy?
Mother organ.
Could you repeat, Vidya ji?
One is the mother of the other organ.
One is the mother of the other organ.
No.
Okay.
When one organ is deficit, the other organ should be in a position to nullify the deficiency by giving energy.
If that is the case, why not three organs is allocated to manage one energy? Why only two?
In that case, two organs, three organs means then one will be deficient or two will be deficient and the other one will be excess. Then that one excess can't equate with the two deficiency.
No, like say one is, like if there are three and each of them are like 33% divided by three, okay? And one becomes excess by 10%. Instead of 33, it becomes 43. So it means that it has taken 5% from the other organ, right? See, the logic is, instead of two organs, there could be three organs or four organs allocated to one energy. Why is that only two organs are allocated? Why not just one organ? Why two? Or
one organ is a solid organ and another one is work functionally. One is solid organs, another one is hollow organ. Mm-hmm. That solid organs work 24/7 and the hollow organs work according to the function time or horary hours.
Mm-hmm. Okay, why not two hollow organ is allocated, or why not two solid organ is paired? Why one hollow and one solid?
ಸರ್ ಸೌತ್ ನಾರ್ತ್ ಮತ್ತೆ ಶಿವಶಕ್ತಿ ಅದನ್ನ ಏನಾರ ಇದ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದಾ
ಮಾಡಬಹುದು
ಎನರ್ಜಿ ಶಿವಶಕ್ತಿ
ಬ್ಯಾಲೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಗಬೇಕು ದೇರ್ ಆರ್ ಡಿಫರೆಂಟ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಡು ಇನ್ ದ ಸೆನ್ಸ್ ಸೀ ಒನ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಇಸ್ ಟೆಲ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ನಾರ್ತ್ ಸೌತ್ ಶಿವಶಕ್ತಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ದಟ್ ಬಿ ಎ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಡೆಫಿನೆಟ್ಲಿ ಯೆಸ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಟ್ರೈಂಗ್ ಟು ಮೇಕ್ ಯು ಥಿಂಕ್ It's not just I keep on saying something and you listen, but you should also.
Husband and wife.
So as per that picture you are showing, see, we need two materials. Only sand alone can't make the vessel, and water alone can't make the vessel. They both have to combine to make the pot.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So for the energy we need for any organ to work, it needs help from the other energy.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Like, great, okay, it is we are moving, okay, one step ahead, that is good. What else is coming?
One organ will work 24/7,
mm-hmm,
and the other organ work only when it is needed.
Mm-hmm. Okay, see, any question, any answer that you post, why not all the organs are working when it is needed? Why is that some organs has to work 24 hours? Why is that some organs have to be intermittent? Why not all organs work for 24 hours? Why not all organs,
vital organs has to work for 24 hours.
What?
See, vital organs, when we want to live, we have to breathe, our heart has to work. So that is a vital organ. It the can't work as we need. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, stomach, mm-hmm, and then spleen, that and all, when we need that, when we eat food only, stomach will work. Stomach, mm-hmm, works, then spleen works, liver works. Like that, vital organs has to work for 24/7, mm-hmm, and the remaining organs, whenever we need that organ, it is working.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That is voluntary and involuntary.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. It is what she is telling is right. I'm just trying to put it in perspective. See, we are not doing same thing for 24 hours. Right, we are not working 24 hours, we are also resting. Our energy consumption varies, right? So there is no point all the organs working all the time, because we ourselves are not working all the time, right? So, and there is no point in all of them are working intermittently. When if all of them stop working, okay, we have to still be alive, breathing has to go on, heart has to pump, all those things. So there are some organs which are allocated, okay, you work all the time. Some of them have been allocated, okay, you work only when it is needed. But I was just curious to understand why I am asking these questions, probing all, is because when you read the book, you should also get the same questions in your mind. Only then we will be able to understand the subject deeply, right? So this question came into my mind. There is just one energy, why two organs? This is how I understand. Say, when a potter is making some kind of object, and in this he is using both of his hands, okay, and when he is pushing from one hand, the other hand is supporting from inside, okay? So he is pushing from outside and his one hand is supporting from inside, and when he's pushing from inside, the other hand is supporting. So in this way, one pushes, one supports, one pushes, another supports. In that way, I can give any form to the raw mud, okay, the way that I want it. And similarly, this whole existence is a potter's wheel, and through this two energies, okay, in different way, we can say different things. Yin Yang, Shiva Shakti. There are two faces of a coin. Okay. Similarly, this supporting energies, two supporting energies are getting used to create the entire existence, and that is why two organs are needed to manage one element. For example, here the mud is just one, but two forces are needed to give it a shape, like push and pull, something like that. Okay. So that is why that kind of, when this concept, when you understand, when you go to the advanced topics like diagnosis, etc., you will be able to understand the disease better and how should I think in terms of PCM. You will be able to understand or, you know, get the clues from this. That, you know, so it is important that you understand why there are two organs in that one pair. Okay. So this is a kind of, it will get into a lot of philosophical things if we get, you know, go deeper into this. So we will just leave it as of now. So what does this mean? Okay, so there are, we know that those who have read the books, they would know that there are two kinds of, the same key has two kinds of varieties. One is the deep bio key and other one is superficial bio key. What does this mean? When there is deep bio key, so imagine earth, whatever is coming from the earth, there is fruits like food, grains, etc. is coming from earth and water is coming from the earth and the air is also coming from the earth's atmosphere. So these three things put together mainly is called deep bioenergy. And what is coming from cosmos? You just sit, so many things are getting interacting with your body. In say ancient sciences, we also say that what are the horoscope. Okay, if you study little bit of horoscope, they say that lot of planetary influences are happening in the body, right? Now moon is moving, the energy from the gravitational force from moon is having an impact on this person, and there are so many planets. And similarly, there are, even when I am just sitting, the human body is just sitting without doing anything, there is still a lot of forces acting on the human body. Gravitational force of the earth, gravitational force of the different planets, and the light coming from the sun, heat coming from the sun. So many things are interacting, and all these invisible energies I put together and call that this is a superficial bioenergy or heavenly key energy. So I can categorize this into two ways. Okay, one is heavenly, which is invisible, and deep bio, which is invisible plus visible. Okay. See, when I drink water, I am taking the element and also taking the element's energy. Okay. Let me go back here. See, when I drink water, say I drink the element is also coming into the system and the energy of the element is also coming into the system. Say I eat some food. So the earth is getting inside the body and the earth's energy, humidity, is also getting inside the body. Similarly, other things. So now here, when I consider it to be deep bioenergy or earthly energy, it is both the element and the energy associated with the element is getting into the system. But when it is only superficial bioenergy, it is only the energy. The element is not getting into the system, right? But when I manage one, I will be able to manage the other also. How is it? Like when there are two phases of one coin, one I change, the other will also get automatically changed. We will take an example. Let us say if I change the energy of the water, the coldness, the water will also get changed. If I change the water, the energy of the water will also change. Say water is liquid and I touch that liquid, it is cold. Now I change the temperature of the liquid. Okay. So I, instead of coldness, I am reducing the coldness in the water by adding heat. So what happens to the water? The water changes. It changes its molecular structure. From water, it slowly starts getting into vapor, right?
Vapor.
I keep on adding heat into the water. So what is happening? I am changing the energy. And when I change the energy, the element also gets changed from the liquid water, it starts becoming vapor.
Now,
vapor, right? And now I increase the coldness. Instead of decreasing the coldness, I increase the coldness by adding more cold. So the water will become
ice.
Yes.
Ice.
As you told.
Ice.
It becomes ice.
Ice. And
similarly with all the other elements. When you are modifying the energy, the element is also getting modified. And when you modify the element, the energy is also getting modified. Say if I drank one glass of water, I had X amount of coldness. But when I drank two glasses of water, the coldness becomes 2x. Twice the coldness is getting into the system. So when the element is changed, the cold energy changes. When the energy changes, the element also changes, right? So here I see that both the energy and the element is coming into the body. Here only that invisible energy is coming into the body. Both of them affect the body, right? So I wanted to discuss only up to this point. And I will, there are so many further things that we can discuss from this, the organ clock, the five creative cycle, etc., etc. But I thought I will discuss that in another class separately. But this I wanted to give just an overview of only the key. Okay, I did not want to discuss the meridian and how things work. So energy, like there is invisible energy and there are different proportions of that invisible energy. And they are coming from different sources into the body. And depending on the proportions, either we become healthy or unhealthy, right? When it becomes too much of heat, too much of coldness, or too much of dryness than required, we become diseased. And what we are doing through acupressure is only we are bringing it back into the balance. Okay. So I wanted to take questions for this session now. Before I take questions for this session, in the previous class, there was one question. I wanted to try to explain it once again. In the previous class, there was a question. See, when we are giving sedate, or when there is, we put, the example given was a plunger. So we know that from the energy gets dispersed back into the meridian. But how is it when we are trying to tone? Where does the energy come from? That was the question. I did give an answer, but I thought I could elaborate slightly more so that it sits, the understanding is better. When we are trying to tone, what happens? The energy from the meridian gets accumulated more towards that point. Okay, it's something like sucking up, so that the energy from other sides come and gets accumulated here. For example, if you imagine, say drinking coconut water using a straw, what happens? The coconut water is rising up in the straw because there is a sucking kind of force being put at one end. So what happens? The fluids flow from bottom, gets into that straw and moves upwards. So there is more liquid available for the mouth to access. Similarly, there is more energy available at that acupoint for whatever is the system below it to access that energy. So I wanted to elaborate slightly more on the previous session's question. So any questions on this? Is everything clear?
Hello.
Yes.
When the body is itself deficient, how is that the energy can produce there?
See, when the body is deficient, there are two things. Whenever we say deficient, there are two ways to think. One is, if one place it is deficient, some place it is excess, like a scale, like whatever we are, see, vegetable scale, etc. One side is going up, it means someplace it is going down. That is one way of seeing. Okay. So wherever there is excess, we will try to transfer it back so that the efficient becomes balanced. Second, then there is some kind of deficiency in the body of physical elements. This previously I gave energy wise. Say for example, vitamin B12 is deficient or some other vitamin C is deficient. How do I fulfill that?
Yes.
So should I just by balancing the points, will I get all the things, or should I put something inside the mouth? Should that vitamin B12 should come inside intake. The mouth?
Intake of that wanted the deficiency.
Yes. Say for example, there is too much of lack of water in the body. I cannot only start working on the points. I have to ask the patient to drink the water also.
Right? Intake of the water.
Intake of the water. So when there is some kind of deficiency of an element, there are two ways to fulfill. One is through balancing internally if it is low level of disbalance. But if it's too much of an imbalance, where it is beyond the modifications or balancing of the meridians, we will have to ask the patient to intake those
physical intake
of those deficiencies.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Welcome. So, any other questions?
Yeah. There's no way what is asked. Intake of the food, but the body when it doesn't have the capacity to absorb that element or that capacity to absorb that vitamin or anything when we intake it.
Okay, the question is, we discussed that the element has to be intaken into the body, but what when there is no ability to digest that particular element, right, or vitamin? Yes. So what do we do? Yes. Like we will have to once again change the functioning or improve the functioning of the organ. So how do we do in acupressure? Once again, using the meridians. Right, I can't go and do something to the organ itself.
Inside.
Right, so I use the meridians to access the organ. So I change few things in the organ depending on the situation and see what best I can
do it. Make
the organ to function.
How do we come to know that it is not it doesn't have the capacity to absorb? How we will come to know that? How can we identify it?
So your voice is very feeble. Is the question that how do I know that it is required an external intake or just the balancing of the? How do I know is a very deep question. So that is what we call it as diagnosis, and it takes long time to understand what is happening inside.
So it may be different for each person, each individual,
it varies,
right?
Say for example, if somebody is taking vitamin B12 tablet, okay,
yes,
and still when they do the blood report, it shows that vitamin B12 is less. What does it mean? It means that the body is not absorbing the vitamin B12. In that case, I'll have to work on the organ. Now, in the blood report, it told that vitamin B12 is less. I did all my treatment, but still vitamin B12 is less. Now I ask the patient, what is your intake, food intake? Now there I came to understand that the patient is not taking a proper balanced diet. So in that case, I'll have to say, okay, you have to eat vitamin B12. I cannot create vitamin B12 out of nothing. Right. In that case, I'll have to advise the patient that they will have to eat vitamin B12. So in that way, in different situation, different kind of strategy has to be used. And that comes with time. The more you practice, the more you read, the more you understand, you will get to know. And it is not just a one day's work. Okay. Did you get the answer?
Thank you. Yeah, yes. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes. Any other questions? So nobody has any other questions. Did you get an idea on how to create questions out of the subjects that we read? Okay, so there was one example that I gave. Anything that you read, okay, you put a question for your. So those who want to get deeper into the subject, this is a very useful tip. Okay, See, always ask why. The most important question is why. So in this slide, okay, because we have some time in today's session, how do I use why to understand deeply? I told liver plus gallbladder is associated with wind. Heart and small intestine is associated with heat. Now I want to understand this deeper. I gave you a hint, use why. How do I use why in this situation?
Can you relate how liver and gallbladder is related to the energy, wood and wind?
Okay, okay. One question is coming up. How is the, why is...
Because kidney and urinary bladder directly we can understand it is water coldness. Mm-hmm. But other than this liver, gallbladder and lung, large intestine, I need to understand better how it relates to that particular energy, metal dryness for lungs and large intestine and liver and gallbladder to wood and wind.
Mm-hmm. Okay. See, this is one way of getting slightly deeper into it. So the book says liver and gallbladder is associated with wind. My mind should work. Why is liver and gallbladder associated to wind? Right? Book says liver and gallbladder associated with wind. My mind should say why? Why not heart and small intestine associated with wind? Why not spleen and stomach associated with wind? Why not kidney and urinary bladder associated with heat? Why only this energy is associated with particular organ? There should be some reason, right? Or it is just random. There should be some reason behind this allocation. And as I told, this is once again an unexplored area. If you want to get answers to this, to some level, there may be some answers in some books, but beyond that, there is no answers, right? So only if you get into this, do little more research and everything you start understanding deeply, you will be able to get a better idea. I cannot say full idea, but a better idea of why, what is happening, right? As per my understanding, any of you were able to attend this, my paper presentation in the, this thing, conference? No? Okay. So I had shared some of these things in liver about these things, why this is associated with this. And it is slightly complicated. Keep this question for another day. I will discuss my paper for one entire session so that you will get some of these answers, right?
Okay.
Krishnanji, I attended and there was few other things where you said why it is associated, and a few of the questions, some says metal, some says other things to metal, like that.
Okay. There were some understanding shared over there. It is quite an interesting topic by itself. Okay. So we will give a good amount of time trying to understand. All of this is once again my thinking. Okay, if you ask me where did you get this information, I have no place to show. Okay, and I again and again say that it may be wrong. What I am telling is not. I cannot guarantee that this is right because these are all unexplored things. Okay, but it helps you logically, it makes sense, and it helps you in understanding the subject better. That is why I am sharing with all of you. Okay, great. Any other question?
Sir?
Yes.
Namaskara, sir. Idu iga five elements ella organs allo ide alva?
Haudu.
ಇಡಿ ಬಾಡಿಲೇ ಫೈವ್ ಆರ್ಗನ್ಸ್ ಇರೋವಾಗ ಈಗ ಅದೇ ನೀವ್ ಹೇಳ್ದಂಗೆ ಗಾಲ್ ಬ್ಲಡರ್ ಮತ್ತೆ ಲಿವರ್ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಮಾತ್ರ ವಿಂಡ್ ಮತ್ತೆ ಹಾರ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿನ್ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಮಾತ್ರ ಹೀಟ್ ಅಂತ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿರೋದು ಇದು ಸ್ಪ್ಲೀನ್ ಗೆ ಯಾಕೆ ಆತರ ಅಂತ ಇಡೀ ಬಾಡಿಗೆ ಇದೆ ಅಲ್ಲ ಫೈವ್ ಎಲಿಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್
ಓಕೆ See, I'll answer it in English so that others when they see the video they get to know. So the question is
Harikesh
Okay, those who are not speaking, you can please mute your mic. Okay, see this thing, the question is, the whole body is made out of five elements. And why is then only selected few organs are associated with each particular energy? Why is that not every element is associated with every energy, right? So the answer is in this slide. Okay. Even if I take one atom from the human body or just one cell, the minutest of the building block, even one cell will have all the five energies, right? If I take a cell of the skin, and if I take a cell of a heart, and if I take a cell of, say, kidney, and I take a cell of liver, what is the difference? All of them have these five energies, but the ratio of that five energy is different in each of them. Okay. Some requires extra heat. Some requires extra wind. Some requires extra coldness. So based on their functionality, and it is quite an intriguing way of understanding these elements. Say, if I give you, you can't make a good sambar out of five basic element ingredients, right? If I give you only five ingredients, it is just difficult to make one good tasting sambar. But the entire existence, everything that you see in this world is just these five elements. How is it? It is because of the ratios of these five elements. You can make infinite number of ratios of these five elements. And because all the functioning of all the organs is not the same. The functioning is different. Therefore, the ratios of these five energies has to be different. Right? And similarly, based on some understanding, they have allocated these particular energy for these particular organs as per TCM. Okay. But why only these organs? There are so many organs missing. There is no pancreas. There is no brain. There are so many things which are not there in TCM. Okay. But why is it not there? Why only these things are there? Does that question ever arise in your mind?
Yes.
In your mind? Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
And what was the answer which came to your mind?
Zero. No.
A triple bomber and pericardium.
Why? How do I understand triple bomber and pericardium? See, in the original TCM, those two things were not given. Okay. Only five elements were given. But later on, when Sir Park Zewu did his research, he added those two things. And he told Tripper Volmer and pericardium. So those two organs he associated with existing organs within the body. Pericardium, he told that it is brain. Tripper Volmer, he told it is spine. But when it comes to Dr. Bohl, he gave a different interpretation of those two things. One is circulatory system and another one is nervous system. So in that way, the people who came later, based on their experience, their understanding and their research, they gave their different interpretation for the existing TCM knowledge. But in the original TCM, those two things were not allocated to any particular organ. Okay. But it is like when we get into deeper things, slowly, slowly you will understand it. Okay. So any other questions?
No.
No? Manjula ji has no questions. Anybody else? Okay. So I think we can end the... So today also, generally, this is a 40-minute time slot which the Zoom gives. I think because we are new, it is not ending the session here. Okay. So if there are no questions, any questions from the previous topic, that we did, the tone and sedate. Is everything clear there?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, fine. Okay, so thank you all for joining. So once again, anybody who wants to, new ones who wants to join, they can still join this Books to Brain series. And as I have told, the fee is 1,000 for the entire year. And the timing is from 6:30 to 7:30, okay, on Fridays. So, and is this time convenient for everyone, 6:30 to 7:30?
Yes, sir.
Yes?
Yes, yes. Okay. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. And
why can't we change the day? Because Friday we had special prayer and all. Even you people also have got prayers.
Saturday, Sundays, people, there will be dedicated sessions from Sanstan or Ishan. So at that time, we can't plan these sessions. So I wanted to do it on another day, which is from Saturday, Sunday. And the ideal time would
Monday
be...
Monday to Thursday?
Pardon?
Monday to Thursday?
See, Monday
any
to...
day.
Just yours is a special case, right? But generally Friday people would have finished the work and come back home looking for weekend, so they will have more time. On weekdays it may be difficult, that is why I have kept this time on Friday. I know that it is difficult for you.
Yeah,
weekdays it may be hectic,
more hectic for different people.
Yes, yes.
So I have it was 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. I thought people, when they come back from work, so by 6:30 they may be able to come back. That's why I've kept it 6:30 to 7:30. And
it's
are
correct.
These sessions, are these sessions useful? Are you getting some value out of it?
Yes, sir. Definitely, we are getting.
Definitely.
Definitely. Definitely.
Definitely. Okay, great. Any suggestions that you want to give on how we can improve these sessions?
Oh no.
Anybody wants to share any suggestions?
I at the end of every week, please place some question. By the way, we can explore the things.
Uh-huh. Okay. Give some.
You place some question to us. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Slowly, slowly it will come. I did not want to.
Okay. We can explore better.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Great.
Yes.
So I will keep that in mind so that I can give you some kind of homework or questions.
Oh, yes. That's nice.
Okay, so that you can work on that and come back in the next week. I had a proper plan to make this thing happen. So any other things that you want to share on how we can improve this, or something is not right?
At this moment, we are not getting anything. In future, we can see.
Okay, okay, great. Okay, so then thank you all for joining. And if you have any questions, you can also put it in the group. So I will see if I can answer. Otherwise, next week I will answer, depending on how much I know the answer. Okay.
Thank you all.
So have a
thank
good
you. Time. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.